Hello and welcome to the next video in our video on the accounting cycle. In this one, we're going to look at one of our financial statements. Today, the focus is going to be on the statement of cash flows. The statement of cash flow is very unique because unlike the other ones, it's actually a reconciliation of the cash account. So it's not trying to depict information at a point in time or anything like that. It's just saying what happened to our cash from the beginning of the period until the end of the period. There's two ways in which you can do the statement of cash flows. One's called the direct method, which is the recommended one. And then there's the indirect method, which is the most popular one and the one that we're going to focus on primarily. Okay, first thing is, with any statement, you have your statement heading, which includes the company name, the name of the statement, which is the statement of cash flows, and then this case here, it's for a period of time. Now, the statement of cash flows is organized in a very specific way. There's three main sections, the operating, investing, and financing section. And at the very end, there's our reconciliation. So the operating section looks at the cash from your operations, which comes from your income statement, that which identifies all of your operations. And each of those accounts is linked to our things called working capital, or our current assets and our current liabilities. So we look at how those change in relation to their impact on our operation. Then we take a look at the investing section, which looks at the changes in our non-current assets, things like our property, plant, and equipment. And then finally, we look at the financing section, which is the changes in our long-term liabilities and the changes in our owner's equity. So you'll notice that between the three sections, every section of the statement of financial position is covered off. In other words, we've captured everywhere where we could have used or received cash from. Once we've done all that, we add up all those changes, and that gives us the changes in cash for the period. We add that to the beginning cash, and then, ba-ba, we have our ending cash balance. So this is a unique statement, again, in that you actually know the answer before you start, because whatever your statement of financial position says is your cash account at the end of the year, that is the answer to this statement. So what do you need to do in order to be able to complete the statement? First thing is a comparative statement of financial position. What that means is you need 2 years worth of data. Because the statement of position is for a point in time, you need the one for the end of the current period and the one from the end of the last period, so that we can figure out the cash that was used between those 2 points in time. You also need an income statement, which is for the period in question, and then typically some additional information, things like, did you buy or sell any additional equipment? Did you pay any dividends? That sort of stuff. So I said there's two methods, the direct method and the indirect method. The method that we talk about here, direct versus indirect, applies only to the operating section. The investing section and the financing section, they don't change regardless of the method. They follow the exact same process. The direct method provides the most detailed information on where your cash came from and where it was used, and is actually recommended by the accounting bodies. But because of time and it's also acceptable, most use the indirect method. At the end of the day, it doesn't really matter. The end result is the same. The cash that is used or gained from your operating activities will always be the same regardless of whether you use the direct or the indirect method. So let's start with our income statement. Here we have one for XYZ company, and we have our sales, cost of goods sold, three expenses, and an overall net income of $9,000. So that tells us our operation earned $9,000 of income. But how much cash did that actually generate? Let's take a look. We'll now use our statement of financial position as well. We'll take a look at the beginning, which in this case here, it was zero, which means it's the first year of operation for this company, and then the end of the fiscal year in 2013. And you can see all the different accounts that are on there, cash, accounts receivable, inventory and equipment, both current and non-current assets. Accounts payable, rent payable, loan payable are all of your liabilities, share capital and retained earnings. A typical statement of financial position. So you need the income statement and you need this information in order to complete the statement of cash flows. So we need to understand a couple things first, because working capital hasn't been talked about a lot so far, but current assets and current liabilities is what we call refer to as working capital of a business. And determining whether the change in the working capital is either a decrease or an increase, I look at it saying, just pick one that you'll remember, and then its attributes follow through for all the other ones. So when I think of current assets, the one I always remember is accounts receivable. When my accounts receivable go down, that means that my customers are paying me, so therefore that is a source of cash. So then when my accounts receivable go up, that's considered a use of cash. On the liability side, one of the most common current liabilities is accounts payable. In the case of accounts payable, when I pay my bills, so in other words, when I decrease my current liabilities, I'm using up cash, so that's a use of cash. Whereas when I have an increase in my current liabilities, it means I'm foregoing the payment of those bills, so that works as a source of cash for me. So you need to remember how these current assets and current liabilities work with one another and how they're related to the income statement. But remember this chart and it'll make it a lot easier. So let's start with the indirect method. We start with our net income, always the bottom line on the income statement. Then we take a look on there. Are there any expenses or revenues on there that are non-cash items? So things that would be examples would be depreciation is an expense that doesn't affect cash, and gains and losses. Gains and losses on the sale of equipment are not cash. They're just something to reconcile between the original historical cost and what we actually receive for cash. And those things are dealt with in other sections of the statement of cash flows. Once we've identified and added back or subtracted any non-cash items, we then take a look at our working capital accounts. How did our current assets and current liabilities change? We use the chart from the previous slide, and then we identify whether it's a source or a use of cash. Let's take a look. So for the operating section, we start with net income, $9,000 right off the statement. Then we say, are there any non-cash items? Well, sure enough, there it was, depreciation. That was the allocation of our asset over its useful life. So in this year, we used up $4,000 of the asset, but we didn't actually pay that in cash. We bought the asset in some prior year. All right, so in this case here, we add back that expense because that reduced depreciation expense reduced net income. So if it's non-cash, we add it back to net income. That's the only non-cash expense that we have. So then we take a look at how did our working capital accounts change? Well, we had an increase in accounts receivable, an increase in inventory, an increase in our accounts payable, and an increase in rent payable. So the increases in the two current assets were both uses of cash. So we subtract those from the cash from operations. And then the two current liability changes were both sources of cash. So we add those back. That will give us the cash used in operations equaling $16,000. So our operation actually cost us money this current year. Not a great thing for business, but it's possible. We can figure out the same section using the direct method now. In this case here, we start with the top of the income statement, sales, then cost of goods sold, then all of the expenses. So basically what we want to do is go one by one between all those. If we then come to a non-cash item, we just skip over it. All right, we ignore it. All right, so then we take our sales and we link them to any current assets that we have. Cost of goods sold, any current assets or current liabilities that they're linked to. And all those payables, are they linked to any of our other expenses? Line by line, we do that on our statement. Let's do it. First thing is we start with sales. Top line of our income statement, we had $80,000 in sales, but our accounts receivable went up, which means not all the customers paid us. So in reality, of that $80,000, we only collected $62,000 in cash. Next one is cost of goods. Well, that's an expense. So that's money that's going out. So we know what we bought and it's already gone in the income statement. That's full out cash paid. So that was $35,000. Then we bought more inventory. That was another increase or another use of cash. So we add another outflow to that other one. And then we have our increase in accounts payable, which is basically a cash inflow. The net result of that is we paid out $47,000 for all of our goods. Next thing we do is rent expense. Rent expense was $11,000, but rent payable went up, which means we didn't pay it all. So there's $1,000 we didn't pay, so the net effect is a $10,000 payment of rent. And then our other expenses, those were $21,000, and there are no associated accrual things like other payables, etc. So therefore, there's no other adjustments. That's a pure outflow of cash. We add all those up, and as expected, it equals exactly what we came up with the indirect method. So what you've seen are two ways to get to the same thing, the cash used in our operations. The indirect method starts with net income, looks at the adds back non-cash items, and then looks at the changes in the working capital, whereas the direct method starts with each, goes line by line on the income statement, and ties those to the working capital accounts, essentially giving you the same result. So there's what we show up on our statement of cash flows. The cash used for operations is $16,000. Next is the investing section. Here's where we look at our non-current assets. I strongly suggest you use a T account to ensure you have all the necessary information. This example is pretty simplistic because it's year one, but many times you're going to have adding and subtracting of assets. So you need to make sure you have all the information. So you also see on there equipment, which says net, which basically means equipment minus accumulated depreciation. So let's start with the equipment account. Started with zero. It ends with 29,000. We know we bought 29,000 in equipment. And if we had any sales of equipment, which would have been part of the other information, it would go on the right side of that T account as a cash outflow. We also put in the accumulated depreciation to make sure we have all the data again. Our depreciation was $4,000 in the first year. The opposite side of that journal entry is the $4,000 credit to accumulated depreciation. It's in there, the account balances. Both these T accounts reflect the values on the statement of financial position. Therefore, we can say that we know we didn't sell any equipment. So we can now say the only investing activity we had, because we only have one line of our non-current assets, is the purchase of machinery for $29,000. The next thing we look at is the financing section. Here's where we look at the remaining parts of the statement of financial position, your long-term liabilities, and your owner's equity. Again, use a T account to make sure you have all the info. Within owner's equity, you need to look at two accounts, share capital and retained earnings. So let's start with the liabilities. We have our loan payable. We had no loan at the beginning of the year because we just started business. We took out a new loan for $12,000. If we'd had any payments, there would be a reduction in that. But as you can see from the statement of financial position, our ending balance was $12,000. So we know our loan was 12 grand and that's it. Next thing is share capital. Again, beginning of business, we had nothing. We issued shares worth $100,000. So now we have $100,000 in share capital. If we'd bought back any shares during the period, they would show up on the left side of the T account. That didn't happen. So we know we received $100,000 in cash from issuing shares. The final sections are retained earnings. Beginning balance was zero. Our net income for the year was $9,000. But if you remember from our statement of financial position, the actual final value was $4,000. So there's something missing, which goes on the left side. Something reduced our net income. If you remember the equation for retained earnings, it's the beginning balance plus your net income minus dividends equals your closing balance. So we know the closing balance was $4,000 per the statement of financial position. That tells you then you had to have paid $5,000 in dividends, a cash outflow. So our financing sources and uses can be summed up like this. A loan of $12,000 was a source of cash. We issued shares for another source of cash of $100,000, and we paid dividends of $5,000 with a net cash impact of cash from financing of $107,000. That now shows up as the third section on our statement of cash flows. We add all those together to show what was the change in our cash for the period. Well, because of all that, the loan and all the issuance of shares, we actually had a net increase in cash over the period. We started with zero. Our ending cash balance was $62,000, and now you can see where it came from. Ladies and gentlemen, that's how you do the statement of financial position, one of the key statements in our financial statement preparation.